Welcome to our service today. It's wonderful to have you with us. I am back in the church, in large part because my house is currently filled with plastic sheets hanging from ceilings to try and reduce the dust as I demolish walls. We share together in our call to worship, which today is from Psalm 16. Protect me, O God, for in you I take refuge. I say to the Lord, you are my Lord. I have no good apart from you. The Lord is my chosen portion and my cup. You hold my lot. The boundary lines have fallen for me in pleasant places. I have a goodly heritage. I bless the Lord who gives me counsel in the night. Also my heart instructs me. I keep the Lord always before me because he is at my right hand. I shall not be moved. You show me the path of life. In your presence there is fullness of joy. In your right hand are pleasures forevermore. We sing together beneath the Southern Cross.
Of the earth we will sing, God is here, the kingdom is near. In the land of the long white cloud, Christ to dwell, Emmanuel.
Inside.
We pray. We are amazed, God, at our power to learn. Some of us learn science and mathematics. Some of us learn cooking and sewing. Some of us learn to care for plants and animals. Some of us learn to care for people, young and old and in between. Some learn to listen and others learn to speak. Some learn to swim and others learn to fly. Everyone is different in what they learn and how they learn. And in our learning, we reflect you, your hidden nature within us. We see you at work in our lives, teaching, guiding, encouraging us as we learn. Sometimes we fail to learn. We return again and again to the same things, choosing to repeat our mistakes, the lessons lost or ignored. Our vision of Jesus, of his gentle leading, blurs and fades. Forgive us for those times of selfishness. Help us to continue to learn as you lead. We bring our private confessions before you now. Know that God pardons all who truly repent and strengthens us through the Holy Spirit in Jesus Christ our Redeemer. Amen. We share together in our reflection. May the peace of Christ be with you. We're going to sing together. My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus Christ, my righteousness.
My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I care not what the spheres bring, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand.
The darkness.
Our reading today is from the book of Mark, chapter 10, verses 17 to 22, The Rich Man. As he was setting out on a journey, a man ran up and knelt before him and asked him, "Good teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life?" Jesus said to him, "Why do you call me good? No one is good but God alone. You know the commandments. You shall not murder, you shall not commit adultery, you shall not steal, you shall not bear false witness, you shall not defraud. Honor your father and mother." He said to him, "Teacher, I have kept all these since my youth." Jesus, looking at him, loved him and said, "You lack one thing. Go, sell what you own and give the money to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. Then come, follow me." When he heard this, he was shocked and went away grieving, for he had many possessions. May the Lord add his blessing to this reading of his holy word. We pray. As we dwell in your word this morning, O God, we pray you would open our hearts and our eyes to discern what your Spirit has for us today. Amen. Okay, team, we're heading out. Have all of you packed spare underwear and a toothbrush? Do I need to ask if everyone's been to the toilet? It will be a while before we find a suitable spot. Peter, did you remember to bring sunscreen? You know what you're like when sunburn hits. That red hair and pale skin do you no favours in this climate. And Andrew, have you packed your lunch? I know the rest likely haven't, but we're used to making do. Now, is there anything else we might have forgotten? No? Then let's get going. We've a long walk ahead of us. Wait for it. Wait for it. Here we go. It was definitely feeling too easy. It's all right. Let him through. All right, young man. What do you have to say for yourself? Good teacher. What must I do to inherit eternal life? Now, hang on just a moment. Why are you calling me good? You know that only God is good. It's a topic for further conversation, but we'll come back to that another time.
Eternal life.
You know what the commandments say. No murder, no adultery, no stealing, no false witnessing, no fraud. Oh, and don't forget to honour your father and mother. They're all there in black and white, and there's been general agreement on what they mean for the last few hundred years. It's not like we've been keeping them a secret or anything. So why are you asking me now? Well, here's the thing. I've been working hard at keeping all the rules, and it's worked out well for me. But I know that there is still something missing. I still haven't found what I'm looking for. I'm not sure what it is, but I know deep down that you know. My friend, you are right, and it is good that you've come to ask. Yes, I know what you're looking for. You've been working on this puzzle your whole life, carefully finding each piece and putting it into its correct place. You've done well, yet it hasn't been enough. You sense it in your bones, but you can't quite put your finger on what the problem is. There's something holding you back from being fully the person God has designed you to be. Here's the thing. All that stuff you've accumulated, the nice house and three cars, the three-bedroom, two-bathroom crib with underfloor heating and double glazing all round, the jet boat, the motorhome, the workshop full of tools, and you do a wonderful job of looking after your parents, you're generous and you share your plenty. All of that is good, and none of it is the point. All that stuff is getting in your way. Every spare moment is tied up looking after it all and trying to get more, which means you don't have the time or the energy to focus on what is most important. But I've worked hard for all of that. I look after my workers and I provide goods and services that other people need and want. Now you're saying I have to give it all away? How is that fair or reasonable? I had no idea that eternal life was so difficult. I'm going to have to think about this. Stepping out of the story now. Over the years, I've alternated between sympathy and some level of dislike for this young man. On the one hand, he's presented with a confronting choice that asks him to give up everything he's worked for over the years. Although, given he's a young man, I often wonder just how much of what he has came from a parent or other benefactor. If you've genuinely worked hard and been successful in what you do, being asked to give it all up is, well, it's tough. It's even harder when it is for something that you can't measure or even be confident of receiving. At least with a few dollars, you can make yourself comfortable in the life in front of you. So I can identify with his shock and grief. On the other hand, my natural distrust of excess wealth can well up and leave me wanting to say, tough nuts, mate, join the rest of us plebs and stop your complaining. Neither attitude is helpful in understanding the story, because it's not about how I feel about wealth. In fact, I don't think the story is about wealth at all. The story is about the sense of loss we all carry from not being truly connected with God. This man knew he was missing something. He just didn't know what it was. Even those of us who have invited Jesus into our lives retain a sense of incompleteness. Paul, writing to the Romans, puts it this way: "But we ourselves, who have the first fruits of the Spirit, groan inwardly while we wait for adoption, the redemption of our bodies." He recognizes that even though we've accepted Christ as our Savior and are filled with the Spirit, we are not done yet. In explaining to the young man that he needed to give up his wealth to receive eternal life, Jesus was responding to that deep sense of loss this young man was experiencing. That sense of loss wasn't because he was wealthy. It was because his focus had been moved from God to something not God. And it is this not God focus that can affect us all.
Wealth, family, work,
health, sport, hobbies. When these things become our focus and move God to second place, we find Jesus telling us to sell what we have, give it away, and follow him. It may not be selling in the commercial sense, rather giving up those things that have led us to finding our hope in whatever that not God is for us. Then, in that space where God is, we can rediscover our identity as children of God. For most of us, that can be just as difficult as the rich young man found out. It is likely we will be just as shocked and grieved. For me, the hardest part of it is that this shifting of my focus is not something I can do once and then forget about. We need to work at it constantly, to keep dragging ourselves back to focusing on God, because the things around us, that if we're honest, are all good things because they've been created by a good God, all too easily draw our attention and our focus away from God. I don't think it is sin, this constantly shifting focus. It's simply human. We are going to dig deeper next week, but I do find it interesting that the disciples were astonished at Jesus' answer. They understood how difficult a task he had set the young man. They also understood that in setting it for the young man, he was also setting it for them and for us. Perhaps it is a part of the reason we are told to not stop meeting together. We need each other to encourage and challenge that focus on God. What do you think? We pray. God of love, of good things, of wonderful creation and creativity, we worship you. We also acknowledge how often our attention is drawn from the maker to the made, and we're sorry for that. Help us to learn what it means to give up our wealth, however that may be measured, to gain the treasure in heaven. Amen. We sing together, "Amazing Grace, My Chains Are Gone," which seems such a suitable song for this message. We sing.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. Was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear? I first believed. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy rains, unending love, amazing grace. The Lord has promised.
We bring our prayers for our gifts and offerings. Mighty God, architect of the universe, your work of creation and building is always before us. We give our gifts this day in hopes that we might be co-builders with you in the creation of your kingdom here on earth. May our gifts also reach others who are hurting, who feel disconnected from your love, that they too may join us in the stonework of kingdom building, whose mortar is the sharing of Christ's love with the world. In Christ our Saviour and Redeemer. Amen. We bring our prayers for ourselves and others. We begin this week with prayers for the people of St. Paul's as they begin to prepare for Rose's time as the new moderator of PCANZ, which is a while away yet, but will require much thought and consideration as they head toward that time. We pray for the more than 650 million living women and girls who, according to UNICEF, were married as children, often married into domestic violence, see their schooling halted, risk death during childbirth, and bear infants who have an increased risk of dying before their first month of life. Lord, have mercy. We pray especially for Chad, Central African Republic, and Niger, who lead the world in these human rights violations. We pray for support organisations as they gear up for Christmas, for funding, for people to help with the work to be done, for physical resources as they are needed, for wisdom and strength to do the work that is before them. We bring our prayers for those we love, for friends, for family, for pets. We are so aware of the needs that we have. Needs for care, needs for love, need for help, need for support, need for encouragement. As we bring these prayers, Lord, hear what we have to say. All these things we pray in the precious name of Jesus, who taught us how to pray. Our Father in heaven, holy be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. We sing together, Christ before me.
Christ before me, Christ behind me, Christ above me and below. Christ beside me, within me, Christ around me, wherever I go. Everything is sacred, everything is blessed, everyone made worthy to find their holy rest. Everyone belongs here, everyone is loved, every life that's failing, grace will lift above. Christ before you, Christ behind you, Christ above you and below. Christ beside you, Christ within you, Christ around. Everything is blessed, everyone made worthy to find their holy rest. Everyone belongs here, everyone is loved, every life that's failing, grace will lift above. Christ before us, Christ behind us, Christ above. Around us wherever we go.
And so as we go out from here, may the God who calls us, ransoms us and sets us free, enable us to find our focus in Christ and our treasure in heaven. And may the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all, now and forevermore. Amen. Go in peace, people of God. Thank you.